do a quick recap of what I said last time, and then we proceed to the integration business. We have given the definitions, but it's not yet complete. Without some things, it's not yet complete. So we'll do that. Okay. So first, let's recap quickly. So we are going to define integration for functions on a measure space. So we have X, F, mu, a very completely general measure space. No restrictions. Mu is not finite or anything like that. Not sigma finite. No assumptions on it. Just a general measure space. And then we define, we take functions, real valued measurable functions. So that's what we'll define, try to define integrals for. And it happened in three steps. Step one was for non-negative, simple measurable functions. So simple functions are ones that look like this. Small a1 times indicator capital A1, small a2 times indicator capital A2, plus small an times indicator capital An, where this capital A1 to capital An are elements of the sigma algebra F. Okay, so otherwise that would not be measurable. We need it to be measurable. So this capital A1 up to capital An have to be in F. This little a1 up to little an are distinct values of real numbers. Okay, not infinity. But in this case, I also take non-negative, so they are all greater than or equal to zero. So a1 up to an greater than or equal to zero, etc. So, and this capital A1 to capital An is in fact a partition of omega. Using, I mean, they are in F and also they are disjoint and their union is X. Okay, so like this picture shows. That is what I defined a simple function as one whose range is finite, which reduces to exactly this, except for the non-negativity part. And for that, we define the integral as small a1 times the measure of this capital A1, small a2 times the measure of capital A2, and so on, small an times the measure of capital An sum. That is what the integral of f is. So this is this is how we denote it. But for just the current class, as I said, just to keep things logically clear, so let me just introduce a notation. Okay, so this will come. In the end, we'll go back to that notation, but just to keep the logical dependence while we are at these steps clear. So for just temporarily, let me introduce a notation. Let me call this I1 of F. Okay, so this is a sort of integral on simple functions. So mu is in the background, mu is centering here. Okay, so this is the integral of a simple non-negative measurable function. Then from there, we go to non-negative measurable function. So F is any non-negative measurable function from X to R plus. You can even allow infinity here, actually. It doesn't matter. And its integral, which again, I change the notation. Let's call it I2 of F. This is just temporarily. I2 of F is defined as the supremum of the integrals of simple non-negative measurable functions which lie below F. Okay, so now I'm just changing the notation. So supremum of I1 of phi, well, phi is non-negative, simple measurable, and phi less than equal to F. So obviously it's non-negative. So it is zero less than equal to phi less than equal to F, and it is simple and measurable, okay? So that's important. So then I1 of phi makes sense, and I2 of F is defined as the supremum of all those I1 of phi. This is a, this supremum could be also infinity, and we are, this is a value in zero to plus infinity, in plus infinity included. And then we go to general measurable function F, and we break it into two non-negative measurable functions. How? We write it as F is F plus minus F minus, right? So F is F plus minus F minus, where F plus is maximum of F and zero. This notation indicates max, F max zero, and F minus is the negative of F min zero. That is, it is a positive number actually. F minus is also a positive function, okay? A non-negative function. So then F is written as F plus minus F minus. And I noticed that mod F is in fact F plus plus F minus. So these are going to be measurable and non-negative because we have seen that max and min of measurable functions, countably many, are going to be measurable. So in particular, that's true for two. f and 0 are both measurable functions, their maximum is measurable, and so on. So both of them are non-negative and measurable. So I2 can be applied to these functions. So therefore, if I just change the notation here, so in the new notation, I2 of f plus and I2 of f minus are well defined because they are non-negative and measurable. And we just define the integral of f as, so this notation will be, yeah, will return. So let's call this I3, that's all. We'll call it I2 of f plus minus I2 of f minus. That's what we will call I3 of f. So I3 of f is I2 of f plus minus I2 of f minus. If both, I mean, provided both are not plus infinity, both if both are infinity, we don't define it. If this is infinity, this is finite, we define it as plus infinity. If this is finite, this is infinite, we define it as minus infinity. But really the important case is where both are finite. Okay, so that is the case that is written below. If both I2 f plus and I2 f minus are finite, then we say that f is integrable. Okay, and in fact, the integral is this. Okay, I can erase this because I have already written this. Is it okay? I just recapped everything. Just change the notation to the three integrals in the three steps are I1, I2, and I3. But really, the point that this is just to stress the point that I2 will be an extension of I1 and I3 is an extension of I2. So it is, in fact, we should use a common notation. But for that, first we should say that, in fact, it is an extension, which we are going to do. Okay, so any questions so far? So what we need to do now is to prove this theorem that I had written, that this integral, so we prove the following statements. Here another thing should be added. So one more thing should be added. If f is non-negative, simple, measurable, then all three, you have three definitions, three integrals, but they are all the same. Okay, and if f is non-negative and measurable, then we have defined, its I2 is defined, so is I3, and they are the same. This is actually something fairly simple, nothing very difficult about it. But so it is actually I1, I3 is an extension of I2, is an extension of I1. That's all it is saying. Okay, this is I3 extends I2, which extends I1. Okay, so it's just an extension. And after that, the main point and that common thing we will denote. So the common notation. So we can call it I or something, but we will use integral x f d mu. Okay, so once we agree on that, then it makes sense to give one common notation. We could call it I of f. But rather than that, we'll call it integral f d mu because it is historically the chosen notation. And then the main point is that association F mapping to this one. So you are sending F to integral F d mu. So that is linear and positive. Okay. So if F and G are integrable and alpha beta are real numbers, then the linear combination alpha F plus beta G is also integrable, and its integral is the linear combination of the integrals. And if F is non-negative, and then its integral is non-negative, I should write here. I can write here equality if and only if f equal to zero, almost surely with respect to mu. Okay, so you remember this means that mu of f not equal to zero is zero. So when we write almost surely with respect to mu some property, it means that the measure of the that it doesn't happen of the complementary set, that is f not equal to zero, set of x where fx is not zero, that has measure zero. Okay, so this is an extra bit I'm adding. I had forgotten that. It's a very useful point also. So this is positivity, and it is kind of equivalent to monotonicity, which is that if f and g are integrable and f less than equal to g, then this follows. So let me just modify it so that I just write this. This we can write as a corollary. Okay, so let's just write positivity. And then as a corollary, you have the monotonicity. Fg, in this case, I assume Fg are integrable and f less than equal to g, then integral Fd mu over x is less than equal to integral gd mu over x with equality if and only if. F equal to g almost surely with respect to mu, meaning the set of x where fx is not equal to gx has zero measure. Okay, so this is the monotonicity. Okay, so that follows from positivity and this, because if f and g are integrable, then g minus f is integrable according to the first statement, and it's a non-negative function, so its integral is non-negative by positivity, but its integral by the first property is integral g minus integral f. Therefore this follows. Okay, so this is monotonicity. So linearity and positivity are really the defining properties of integration. Later we will see a theorem to the effect that if you have a large class of functions and you have some way of associating real numbers to it, all these functions in such a way that that association is linear and positive, then that will arise as the integral with respect to a measure. Okay, so that will be an important theorem of Ries. Okay, so I now so this was all a recap. Any questions so far? I mean, this was all a recap, but is there any question about the plan? So this theorem is unproved. To prove this theorem, I have to go back to each of the steps and do much more. Okay, so that's the idea. So now we will go back to each of step one. I will elaborate on step one. There is a little bit to unpack there. And then we will go to step two, unpack it, and then go to step three. Okay, that's what we are going to do. But before that, if there are any questions, please ask.
Sir? In the third definition, you said that integration of f plus d mu and integration of f minus d mu both are finite, then f is integrable.
Yes.
But if one is finite and one is infinite, then can we say that is integrable?
No, we don't say it is integrable. We give the integral as plus infinity or minus infinity, but that we don't say f is integrable.
Okay.
Yeah. We write integral f d mu is infinity. We write sometimes, but we don't say that f is integrable. Whenever I say f is integrable, the integral has to be finite.
Okay. Yeah, okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, so now let's go back to step one. So if f is non-negative simple measurable, let's say, this thing, AIs are elements of F and a partition of omega. So then I1 of F was defined as pain. Okay. So always X, F, mu is fixed. So we are not going to refer to that again. I mean, it's always this measure space. So this is the thing. And what we want to, so first let's, before stating any properties of this, let me observe some things. Let me just ask a question here, sort of. Suppose G is some function. Let's call it is B1 indicator, capital B1 plus dot, 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 Bn indicator, capital Bn. Okay, so where Bi are in F and Bi are real numbers. Okay, so then I say G is simple. So is that clear? So I'm not saying that Bi's are disjoint or the union is omega. So here in this form, A1, A2, An are actually distinct. Here I'm not saying Bi's are distinct. So the point is Bi need not be distinct. And Bi need not form a partition. Still, it's a linear combination of indicator functions. Is it simple? Is it a simple
one? You can always disjointify it, right? And then
Okay, so that's what we will do. But first and foremost, the starting point, I said the simple function is one whose range is a finite set. It is clear that the range here is finite, right? Okay, I mean, so you take any x, g of x will be a linear combination of bi. So it will be some, how many possible sums of bi's are there? 2 to the n different possible sums, right? I mean, so some x may belong to multiple bi's. Therefore, the value of g at an x could be b1 or b2. It could be b1 if x belongs to capital B1, but not any of the others. But it could also be b1 plus b5 plus b6 if it belongs to those three sets and not any of the others. So, but anyway, the number of possibilities is finite. So you have sums of small bi's. So there are only 2 to the n of them. So it's clear that g is simple. Okay, so because range of G is finite. So the possibility for Gx is all possible sums of small b1 up to small bn. Okay, all subset sums, so to speak. So, but what is the, but this is the form in which I must write to calculate the integral, right? The integral was defined after putting it in canonical form. So this, how to put it in canonical form? Canonical form means I want to write it as some number times indicator like this, where the sets form a partition and these numbers are distinct. How do I do that? So the claim is,
I don't know if it's just me, your audio is cutting off.
My voice is cutting off, or the is it the, is the
voice? It's fine now.
It's fine now. Okay. If it happens again, let me know. So what I was saying was, I would like to put G in the canonical form, which means it is like this, where the numbers here are distinct and the sets form a measurable partition of omega. Okay, they are measurable sets whose part disjoint, pairwise disjoint, and the union is omega. How do I put it like this? It is not difficult at all. So for example, just let's do a simple case here so that we get the idea. So if you have, let's say n is 2. So g is b1 times indicator b1 plus b2 times indicator b2. Okay. So if you write a picture, omega is here. Sorry, not omega. What did I do? I got into my usual habit of a probabilist. So what I meant here was partition of x. My space is x. So this is my space x. Okay, and what is b1 and b2 here? In this case, b1 and b2 need not be disjoint, right? Maybe this is b1. And that is b2. So on b1, I have b1 times indicator b1 plus b2 times indicator b2. So what are the values of g? Okay, so these two are not disjoint and the union is not x. But we see what its values are. Its values are, if a point is in b in capital B1 but not in B2, here the value is B1. Here the value is B2. Here the value is B1 plus B2 because both indicator B1 and indicator B2 are 1 here. And here the value is 0. So that is how we write. So G can be written as, so in this case, G is actually B1 times indicator what? What is this set? It is B1 intersection B2 complement. The part of B1 that's not in B2. You can write B1 set minus B2. That's another way to write it. But same as B1 intersection B2 complement plus B2 indicator B1 complement intersection B2, right? That is where it is B2 plus B1 plus B2 indicator intersection of B1 and B2. On B1 intersection B2, it is this sum. And outside, it is 0 times indicator B1 complement intersection B2 complement. Because if it's outside both, then the value is 0. That is what G is, right? So this is in canonical form. You see, these four sets form a partition of X. They are disjoint, pairwise, and their union is X. And the values B1, B2, this is when B1 and B2 are different. Okay, strictly speaking, this is not the canonical form unless B1 and B2 are different. So if B1 equal to B2, then you will just combine those two, right? If B1 equal to B2, actually this is not entirely the canonical form. You have to still adjust it a little bit because it is possible some of these sets are empty, in which case you drop it. Okay, so there are some caveats here. So if some sets are empty, drop them. For example, if B1 is contained in B2, then the first part, B1 intersection B2 complement will be empty. Then you just drop this term, okay, drop their terms. Also, if B1 equal to B2, it could be, these are not necessarily guaranteed to be distinct. If B1 equal to B2, you should write it as B1 indicator, you just combine those two things, B2 complement, union, B1 complement intersection B2 plus that is then this becomes 2B1 times indicator B1 intersection B2 plus 0 times indicator B1 complement intersection B2 complement. Okay, it seems a little pedantic, which it is, but better to be careful, that's all. Since we defined integral in the canonical form, we should bring it to canonical form, so to speak, to write this. So the what I want to say is that is this, that irrespective of this, my claim is
it's 4 o'clock.
So G is simple. I1 of G can also be the same formula can be used in the non-canonical form. That's what I want to say. Okay, B1 mu of B1 up to Bn mu of Bn. Okay. So this is what I want to say. This makes it simple. So this allows us a lot of flexibility. You don't have to, once you justify this statement, then when you have a simple function, you don't need to bring it to canonical form to write its integral. You can write it in the non-canonical form also. Okay. So, but what is the canonical form? Okay, so that we need to figure out to be able to prove this, because I can define the left side only after bring it to canonical form. I did it in the case n equal to 2. What will it be in general? Can somebody guess? Okay. The canonical form of this will be let's write it like this, a sub s indicator a sub s, where the sum is over all subsets of 1, 2 up to n. A sub s is sum over bi in s, and a sub s is union bi, intersection. I will write and then explain. So the canonical form is going to look like this, ins intersection ins complement bi complement. So this will be the general canonical form will have up to 2 to the n terms. So of course, this is not entirely the canonical form for the reasons I said here, but let's worry about that later. What is this? I mean, see, we take all subsets of 1 to n. In this case, subsets of 1 to 2 are either empty set, the singleton 1, singleton 2, and 1 comma 2. So for each of them, we take the AS, which is the indicator of this. So for example, when the singleton 1 I take, I get B1 intersection B2 complement. When I take the singleton 2, I get B1 complement intersection B2. When I take the set 1 comma 2, then I get B1 intersection B2. And the value will be the sum of the values of BIs on that. Just give me a moment. Hey, so come in, buddy. So I will leave it for you to check that this is the canonical form. Okay, of course, if so, with the caveat that one, drop the term S if AS is empty. Okay, so then we don't need to keep that term. It is empty set, then you don't keep that term. Secondly, if AS equal to AT, so S not equal to T, then club them together. To write, instead of AS indicator A sub S plus AT indicator A sub T, we will write it as AS plus, you will write it as, what will you write it as? So these sets are first of all, AS AS indicator. So the point is, these will form a partition. These AS form a partition. These will always form a partition of X. They are pairwise disjoint, and their union is all of X. Just like in the case n equals 2, these are very trivial things. I mean, trivial, but you need to maybe think about it a few minutes to just verify. So with this caveats, this is the canonical form of G. Okay, so you can check that. That with that I can verify this claim. Is there any question about what I am saying here? Because I1 is defined only in the canonical form of a simple function. For this, I have to see what is the canonical form to be able to write this. That's all I mean. Okay, and I am saying this is what it is, and you check why that is true. So I'll just assume that, and I'll just give the proof here that I1G is this. Once you do that, I1 of G will be, if I take, let me not worry about the caveat part. You can worry about the caveat part, but let me assume this is the canonical form. As mu of as, right? Over all s subsets of 1 up to n, which I denote like this. Okay. So if, at least if as are distinct, then this will be the thing. Okay. So then, what is this actually? Summation. So let me just write sum over all s of sum over bi. INS multiplied by mu of intersection BI, or just let's write AS. I can bring that later, the form of mu of AS. But this will, let's write it as sum over I equals 1 up to N. When does BI come? Let's look at BI. When does it come? It comes over all S such that S contains I, right? When all does BI, particular BI come? B1 comes for all sets which contain 1. B2 comes whenever a set contains 2. So if a particular BI will come in all sets S where which contain the element I. No? Now the claim is, what is this? What is the sum of mu of AS? These are pairwise disjoint. My claim is that AS, all those sets containing I, if you take the union, you just get the set B sub I. Okay. You remember AS is this. AS is this. All of them contain BI. So you will have B1. Let's say I is 1. So AS will be B1 intersection with the rest of them, maybe B2 or B2 complement, B3 or B3 complement, and so on. When you add up over all possible subsets, you will just get BI. Okay, this is more or less similar to the statement that AS union will give you X. It's in fact the same type of statement. So because of this, this will be just, they are pairwise disjoint and the union is BI, and this will be mu of BI. So that was the claim, that I1 of G is summation BI mu of BI, okay? So it seems a bit of an overkill to have to prove this statement. It may seem obvious, but okay, many things seem obvious but are not true. So we're just being careful. Is it okay? Any questions? So the point is, when you have a simple function, in irrespective of what form it is, you can write down its integral very simply. You don't need to go back to disjointify and all that. It is done once and for all here. After that, you don't need to do it again. Okay. With this, now let me state the proposition that I want. Oh, this is actually the simple proposition. So if FG are non-negative, simple, measurable, and alpha beta are non-negative real numbers, then alpha f plus beta g is non-negative, simple, measurable. And let's call it h. I1 of h is alpha times I1 of f plus beta times I1 of g. So this is the sort of linearity part, but we don't call it linearity because here we want non-negative functions. I1 is defined only for non-negative functions, right? Non-negative simple functions. So we can't take linear combinations. We have to take non-negative linear combinations. Alpha and beta have to be non-negative. So this is strictly speaking not general linear combinations. Secondly, if FG are non-negative simple measurable and F less than equal to G pointwise. What that means is Fx less than equal to Gx for all x. Then I1 of F is less than equal to I1 of G with equality if and only if F equal to G almost surely with respect to me. Okay, so this is the linearity, so to speak, the analog of linearity and positivity, but restricted to simple functions. So this is the statement I want to prove, and then this will be needed in going to the next step. Okay, so this will take this class and next class. Now I see that doing the full three steps will take all that. This is not a difficult part. Actually, one part we have actually, because of this reduction, it's actually very simple because H is, so let's write F is A1 times indicator A1 plus blah, 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 AN times indicator AN and GB. B1 times indicator B1 plus maybe a different number of things, indicator Bm. Then what is H? H is alpha F plus beta G, right? So I can write it as alpha A1 times indicator A1 plus up to alpha An times indicator An plus beta B1 times indicator B1 plus beta Bm times indicator Bm. Now, because we have already established this claim, we don't need to worry about canonical forms of simple functions. Now, we can just simply say I1 of F is summation Ai mu of Ai I1 of G is sum up to M, let's call it J, Bj mu of capital Bj, and I1 of H is, you have to do it for all this, is sum over I equals 1 up to N alpha Ai mu of capital Ai plus sum over J equals 1 up to M beta Bj mu of Bj, right? Because that's how we have written. And now we see that this is just alpha I1 of F plus beta I1 of G. Okay, so it's trivial, but it would not be trivial unless you proved this claim before that you could, because even if F and G you took the canonical forms, when you write H like this, there is no guarantee this is a canonical form. Typically it's not going to be, because there are going to be intersections of A1 with B1, A1 with B2 and so on. So you will have to do the disjointifying job. So that we have already done in general. That is the purpose of this claim, which makes our life so much simpler. So I1 of H is just directly writable in this form, even if it's not the canonical form. That's the point. Okay, so we get the, this proves the first statement. Okay, that, okay, I didn't write out that alpha F plus beta G is simple is clear because I didn't write it out, but okay, let me just say it in words. F takes n values, let's say G takes m values, then alpha F plus beta G can take how many values? M times n, because it's a sum of two things, maybe the at most mn times mn different values are possible. So it takes finitely many values. That is okay. For thus, this is the first part. So second part, suppose F just is equal to G pointwise and F is Okay, so what can we say now? Well, what I want to say is maybe I will in view of the time, let me just say that can find a common representation. So let's not even use this. Can find a common partition C1 up to CP of X with CI in F such that F is A1 indicator C1 plus up to AP indicator CP. G is B1 indicator C1 plus up to. See, what you have to do is you can start with this way. The point is F will use a partition like this. Okay, F is constant on this, constant on this, constant on this, constant on this, constant on this. Okay, but G will be constant on some different things. So maybe G is constant on the upper part and then between those two lines and so on. Now the thing is in each of these parts, both F and G are constant. So these are the C's. Okay, so P will be at most Mn really. So you can take all AI intersection BJ. Those will be the C's. You can throw away the empty sets among them. And then you can write this common representation where both F and G are constant on each CI. Now I'm not saying AIs and BJs are AI need not be distinct. If you do this, AI need not be distinct. And same with BJ. Need not be distinct. But we don't care because we have already our claim behind us. So I1 of F and then F less than equal to G implies AI less than equal to BI. This common partition means that on this set C, on some you take some CI, on the set CI, F takes the value AI, G takes the value BI. So AI has to be less than equal to BI if CI is not empty, right? Okay, so we assume that CIs are not empty because I have already thrown away the non-empty ones. CI in F and CI are not empty. We can assume that because I throw away the empty ones. And then F less than equal to G means AI less than equal to BI for all I. Hence, I1 of F, which is A1 mu of C1 plus, I use this representation to write it as AP mu of CP. It is less than equal to B1 mu of C1 plus BP mu of CP because term by term A1 less than equal to B1, AP less than equal to BP, and we are multiplying by non-negative numbers. And this is I1 of G. And you also see that if equality here, then AI equal to BI if mu of CI is positive. Equality, actually, let's write it like this. Equality here, if and only if. Equality can hold here. See, if some mu of C1, if it is positive, then A1 has to be equal to B1. Otherwise, this becomes strict inequality. So that's what I'm writing here. Equality holds here, if and only if AI equals BI for all, whenever mu of CI is positive, okay? So that's why that's the same as F equal to G, almost surely with respect to mu. Yeah, that's an easy thing to see. F and G are simple functions. So if mu of CI is positive and F and G are different there, then F G can't be equal almost surely and vice versa. It is easy to see. So these properties are actually simple, but this claim was essential to do that. Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, let me state the most important thing. Sorry, I went a bit slower than I expected. So there is a most important point which I will state now and then we will prove it next time. That is what is key to, this is one thing about simple functions, but now I come to a really key thing and it's a very special feature of Lebesgue theory of integration. So I write, it is called MCT for simple functions. So later we will see, this is a special case of something that we are going to see later, but we have to prove the special case before you can go to the general case. So this stands for monotone convergence theorem. So this is the monotone convergence theorem is a key theorem in Lebesgue integration theory, but this is a kind of a on the way to it, we need this, that is, that comes later, but on the way we need this provisional version of monotone convergence theorem, so to speak, that is for simple functions. What it says is, suppose I have where suppose I have a sequence of simple non-negative measurable functions which increase to another simple non-negative measurable function. I assume all these phi n's and phi are simple, non-negative and measurable. And this happens, all this is point-wise. So there are many point-wises here. What I mean is phi 1 less than equal to phi 2 is point-wise. Phi 1 x less than equal to phi 2 x for all x. Similarly, convergence is point-wise. Phi n of x increases to phi of x for each x. That's what I'm assuming. Okay. So the statements here is phi n of x is less than equal to phi n of plus 1 of x for all x in capital X. Also, phi n of x increases to phi of x for all x in capital X. So that, and suppose we assume this, then the claim is that I1, the integral of phi n will increase to integral of phi as n goes to infinity. Okay. So that is the statement which we will prove next time. So this is actually a key step to go forward. One way is kind of clear. Each of I1 of phi, because of monotonicity that we have already proved, I1 of phi 1 is less than equal to I1 of phi 2, less than equal to I1 of phi 3, and so on. And all of them are bounded by I1 of phi. So this sequence of real numbers is bounded by I1 of phi. So, and they are increasing. So they will have a limit, possibly plus infinity, but they will have a limit which is less than equal to this. So it is clear that this increase, so we'll have a limit, and that limit is less than equal to this, but that is actually equal to this. That's what we need to prove. So I will do that next time. So I will stop here now, and if there are any questions, you may ask.
Sir, about the midterm.
Midterm, yes.
Yes, so
I have not graded everyone's, by the way. As soon as I grade somebody's, I am returning it. So only a few of you have got it actually.
Yeah, I just got it. I was hoping you could also send me the corrected copy if that was possible.
Yeah, I was planning to do all the emailing at the end.
Okay, sure.
Is that okay? I mean, do I send it for email or is there a better? I also wanted to know if there is a better way to do that, because I can't do editing or writing anything, annotating on the Teams. I don't know how to do.
Yeah, I think the corrected copy is probably better by email. I think that's how I do it.
So then I have about 30 copies to email. So I will. It is best for me to do it
in one sequence.
Okay. Yeah.
Sir, and how much is it weighted for?
It is out of 50, but let me see how the performance is overall. Sometimes it has happened that exam turns out to be way more difficult than it is. So I sometimes decrease the total for it, but that's okay. Anyway, now I don't have to officially upload it, but I will tell you people if I have to do that. If a lot of people do well, then I don't do that. But if everyone does badly, then I decrease the total to some extent. It is set out of 50 at the moment. Any other questions? Comments?
Sir, how will be the voltage in assignment and each and every midterm and interim?
Oh, we decided something, right? I mean, I have forgotten, but I thought we decided something like, so 70% will be 70% will be based on midterms, quizzes and homeworks. So I thought we decided 30 or 40% for midterms and correspondingly 40 or 30% for the homeworks and quizzes, right?
Yes, likely that, but yeah, exactly that was not okay. Decided. Yeah.
Somebody remember which was 30, which was 40, like that? See, you don't need to worry too much on these things in the sense that I often do a weightage with advantage to students. You don't have to, like, even with midterm, sometimes I, if depends on how people do. If they don't do well, then I often weight the maximum of the two midterms higher than the minimum of the two midterms. So you, it's always weight to students' advantage usually. Only if you are doing extremely well, you may be unhappy that others are also getting higher marks, but hopefully you don't bother about such things. But otherwise, it's, you don't really need to worry. Okay, I'll figure that out, okay? I don't remember which is 30, which is 40.
Yes, thank you, sir. Sir, I have one question regarding this proof, the second proof, yeah. So, like, each partition CI is non-empty, but it can happen that small ai is 0 or small bi is 0 in that particular partition.
No, here they are never, because these are range, right? So if I take F2 have the canonical form, this one, then...
No, sir, next one, that F equals to like A1, like 2CP.
Yeah, AI is maybe 0 also, that's okay.
Yeah,
yes. We don't care, it's okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Makes no difference here.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, like CI is non-empty means like we'll get either AI or BI, like, or maybe both, yeah.
No. I mean, basically, I take AI intersection BJ, okay, where AI is anything from 1 to N, J is anything from 1 to M, all AI intersection BJ, okay? On AI intersection BJ, F is AI and G is BJ, so they are both constant. But some of these intersections may be empty, in which case I drop them. I don't need to keep them. So the remaining I will label as C1, C2, C3, that's all. So in this picture, if you see, the bottom here, maybe this is A1, this is A2, this is A3, and so on. This is B1. I mean, let's say the bottom one is B1, B2, B3, and so on. So A1 intersection B1 is empty here. So I don't need to keep that. But A1 intersection B2 is here. A1 intersection B3, A1 intersection B4. A2 intersection B1, A2 intersection B2, and so on. Some of these, if they are empty, I drop them.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, I'll stop recording. People who need to leave, I mean, for the other meeting, please go ahead. And if any